Drive with confidence. From routine service to complete engine repairs, you can trust the pros at A1 Quick Oil to get you back on the road safely. Drop it off or sit and wait in customer-friendly comfort. Behind Napa off Highway 51 North, give Bobby a call.
Here at A1, we don't work on cars, we fix them.
We continue now with Karolyn Harrell, who is a candidate for City Council here in Hammond. But you know, before we get started, I think we ought to, well, explain the bear.
The bear behind me is the only bear that I know of in Hammond, sitting in a restaurant, as you see him here to greet you at the door, at Mr. Mule's, owned by Mr. Dan Lambert. So
this was just a great place to meet, and let me say, a great place to grab a bite when you're in downtown.
Oh, my children love to eat here. Love to eat here. They ask all the time if we can get takeout from Mr. Mule's, so.
And everybody loves the bear.
Everyone loves the bear.
So, I want to talk about your candidacy for the City Council, but first I can't help but go off on somewhat of a tangent because you're working on a doctorate, I hear, in criminal justice, and you actually teach criminal justice. So, maybe you're not an expert, but you're close. In these days, there is no issue bigger, whether it's in Hammond or the nation writ large, than juvenile crime, and it's a devotion of yours.
It is. So I have 10 months left in my doctoral program, and it is actually in education. My bachelor's degree and master's degree are in criminal justice. My master's degree in juvenile justice. It is a passion. It is something that I have dedicated my career to. I'm really excited to talk about it and help solve those problems.
Well, there's no question that there's a surge here in Hammond. The only question is it any different than most places?
So I would say yes, it is different because there are successful proven programs just down the interstate from us. When you ask someone, how do we solve this problem, you kind of get a cliche answer. I've watched your interviews and you get, oh, it takes a village, right? So, well, yes, we all know it takes a village. Well, what should the village be doing? That's why we elect leaders. And if you look, for instance, if you say to me, how can we partner with education to fix this problem? One only needs to go to Alexandria and look at Judge Elizabeth Cook. She has built a successful program where she's partnered the local court, the Herfins Court, with the school system, and they have actually reduced suspensions and expulsions through her program by double digits, and she's received national recognition for that. We can go down the interstate to Lake Charles. If you ask me, how does the community as a whole partner with justice services to solve this problem? I would say, look at Lake Charles. They built the MARC, which is the Multi-Agency Resource Center. Law enforcement arrests a juvenile, walks into the center, and there's a representative from every state agency and community agency that works with children there. The law enforcement officer simply drops the child off. They're processed through the MARC, and they have also received national recognition for that. So if you ask me how economic development partners with a community to solve juvenile crime, I would say look at Judge Marshan and Monroe. Judge Marshan and Monroe built a program that partnered workforce with the courts for first-time offenders. It too has received national recognition. So we don't have to reinvent the wheel, right? The solution is out there.
And is it integrating a three-dimensional approach that every level is working together in an omnibus approach?
Yes. So while I say it's cliche, it does take a village, right? It does take an entire community, but we have to know specifically what can we do in our role that we currently play to help solve this problem. And so you're right.
So what do we do? I mean, how do we even get started?
So I would say instead of attempting to reinvent the wheel, we simply just take a drive and go look at the models that are successful and ask ourselves, can we replicate this model, right? So if we want, we have a new judge who was just elected to our local courts. If we want a solution to come from the courts and our schools, then we would definitely need to go and talk to Judge Cook over in Alexandria and ask her to tell us about her program. I think if anyone looks at the numbers, they would say this is absolutely a successful program. She would not have been recognized in Washington, D.C. for her efforts. And copy paste.
One thing that's occurred to me is that the worst juvenile crime began with truancy. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you could have kept that kid in school, maybe none of those other bad things would have happened. Maybe it would have set in motion a series of good things.
Mm-hmm. Right. And honestly, here in Hammond, you have juvenile probation officers who are in the homes of these children. They know their names, they know their families, and they understand the struggles that are happening behind closed doors. And right on Club Deluxe Road, you have the State Office of Juvenile Justice, which houses your Hammond unit of probation officers. You can go and ask them, what would solve this problem? How do we keep our kids in school? I guarantee you, they will have the answer, and they'll be glad you asked.
I think a lot of these programs that we're describing, they just hit a hiatus, and that's putting it charitably, during the years of the pandemic. In other words, we lost a lot of the momentum we had. The new superintendent knew at that time, Melissa Stille, had dramatically reduced the dropout rate, cut it more than in half, dramatically reduced the truancy rate, cut it by more than half. But then we made all the students virtual. And a lot of kids, I think, fell through the cracks, and we're now trying to recover back to where we were in 2019.
Right, so you can't overwhelm your support services, right? We have great probation officers, we have great local court staff, we have great schools, but they can only do as much as they can do with the staff and that they are allowed, right? So if we're going to have, and if there's an increase in clientele, for example, if probation and parole on Club Deluxe sees a drastic increase in children who are coming from the courts onto their rosters, then they need support. They need support from the community. They need financial support from the state. They need support from their courts. So I think maybe there was this influx of children to all of our various support systems, and the support for that staff may not have been there.
What about the mental health component? Because it's very clear that we have a nationwide mental health crisis for our young people. If that's true, boy, in Louisiana, we've been cutting mental health for at least the last 20 years, if not longer than that.
Correct. You know, there are more clinically mentally ill people currently in our jails and prisons than there are in all of our mental health hospitals combined. And that's a big problem. Last year or the year before, the National Sheriff's Association, with several of our local sheriffs here, went to D.C. to ask Congress to do something about this, because we cannot have our jails and prisons become the de facto mental health hospitals.
But they are.
But they have become that. And so now you have sheriff's offices and police departments that are running jails that have to hire full-time nursing staff for this reason. And so, again, another problem that our elected leaders need to solve.
But looking at the need of our young people, what do you do? Because if you can agree that X number need mental health, but there are no such services available or woefully few compared to the need, how do you reinvent the wheel?
Again, I think, you know, no one person knows all things. And I would recommend that we go and talk to those people who are currently working with our Hammond youth in mental health, right? For instance, I know that at Florida Parishes, Joey Dominic has a great mental health staff there. I know a few of them quite well. They do a great job. They know what the needs are, and they know where those gaps exist and how we can fill those gaps in. It's talking to the right people. I don't want to talk to an elected leader about how we fill in that specific gap. I want to talk to the person who's in the trench with this child, who's in their home, who's working with them. The counselor over at Juvenile Probation in Hammond, I want them to tell me.
Anybody in Hammond who didn't think that we had a youth crisis, I guess that was all dispelled by the unfortunate happenings at the Hammond High School graduation.
Correct. You know, I've worked with juveniles who have been adjudicated by our local courts for many years. I was the coordinator of a MacArthur Foundation grant in addition to my duties as a professor. And in that time, I've worked with several children from the local Hammond area. And one of the things that has stuck out to me was this child who, very intelligent young man, I'm not going to divulge his name, obviously, for confidentiality reasons. But he said to me, "Ms. Harrell, I know you're trying to help me. I know you're giving me all these resources. But here's the reality. I'm not going to stop selling drugs. And here's why." And he pulls this wad of money out of his pocket. And he says to me, "I can't make this doing anything else. So jail's just a job hazard. And I'm letting you know that I appreciate what you're doing, but I'm not going to walk away from this money." And so that leads me back to, okay, well then how do we solve that problem? Again, how can we partner economic development and workforce with our juvenile systems to solve that?
So one of the things that I've learned recently is that apparently there is a road to stardom through YouTube and other platforms if a kid performs, and that's the choice of word, criminal behavior and films it. In other words, you can create this persona that you're a tough guy and get rich on YouTube doing it. How do you combat that kind of money?
I do not know. This is new. I had no idea that there was this new lucrative business opportunity to become an entrepreneur on YouTube. So, you know, again, let's get very specific about what the problems are and ask ourselves how we solve that. We have to find the right people. You have to know what you don't know, right? If you're going to build a team that's really going to solve a problem, then you find the people who are good at those things that you are not, and you ask them to come and help you. And so I think that's what leadership is. Say, so, you know, I can sit here and tell you I don't know, because I don't, but I will. We can always go and find the expert.
Do you really think on the city council that you'd be able to bring this expertise and experience that you have to bear on solving this kind of a problem, or at least making a big dent?
I would love the opportunity to do that. This is a passion of mine. It is something that I have worked on my entire life, and I feel like we can bring people together to solve these problems. We can become a model for success just like other cities around us. You know, we don't have to sit here and bang our heads against the table and ask, oh my gosh, how do we fix this? We know how to fix it, right? You just need politicians that get along with one another, who are willing to sort of hold hands and walk through it together.
I'm attorney Pat Dunn. Auto accidents are a part of life. I hope you never need an attorney, but if you do, the team at the Mack Law Firm is here to help. Don't be intimidated by large insurance companies who just want to make your problem go away. We are here to represent your rights and interests. Contact me today at tangylawteam.com and let's get to work.